And we are live. Hello, everybody. Welcome back. It is November 24th. It's still Black Friday. Is it Black Friday? Yeah, Black Friday. We have 1 minute left of Black Friday. I'm going to give you all one of those bad boys right there. I have friend and fellow rocker, Mr. Philip McKnight, joining me this evening. Philip, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing well. Did you have a nice Thanksgiving?
I did. I was waiting for the show to start to mute it.
Oh,
yeah, had a good Thanksgiving. How about you?
Well, let's do a proper cheers, everyone. Hello, everyone that's joining us. Thanksgiving was good, you know, family time. I was like probably most of us. I was out there to seeing what Black Friday deals, and of course Cyber Monday usually gets a little better for the stuff that didn't move for Black Friday. But this is definitely a good weekend to see what's out there. And here's a little trick. We'll start off with a little trick. If you're unsure about something, put it in your shopping cart, and chances are you're going to get an email of, hey, or even if it's eBay or Reverb, the seller will usually send you an email. Hey, we see you didn't buy it. If you'd like an extra X off, you could do that. So, you know, good little buying tip for you. If you could be patient and there's enough of them left where you could roll the dice on that. But I'm curious to know, did you get anything, buy anything for Black Friday / Cyber Monday? And if anyone in the chat bought anything, I'd be curious to know from you as well if anyone got any good deals on anything.
Yeah, I bought a D'Angelico Mini hollow body.
Those are great guitars.
Brown Burst. Yeah, this is their new one, the Premier. I guess it's replacing this older series. So I got that one. And then I got some DiMarzio Marine Green, which is weird because it's like Army Green guitar cables with the breakers, you know, the cutoff switches.
Okay.
I have some now. I like them. They're just too long. And I was going to cut them down, but those prices, they were great. So I got a couple of those, and I think I got some hot pink ones because they come in every crazy color.
Yep. And you ordered those directly from DiMarzio?
Yeah. And then I did a set of 7-string humbuckers in white with black pole pieces for one of my 7-strings. Yeah.
Nice. Yeah, one of my favorite DiMarzio sets is the Super Distortion in the bridge and the PAF Pro in the neck. It's my go-to.
Yeah, it's a good set.
In fact, one of my most popular videos I ever did was, I've been doing this for a while, so this was before everyone else did how to wire a pickup video. And those were the pickups I was putting in my BC Rich TTK1 Mockingbird. It was the Super Distortion and the PAF Pro.
Nice.
So it looks like some folks got some pretty good deals. Mesa Boogie, $400 off.
That's definitely a post-Gibson thing. Pre-Gibson, you would never get a Mesa Boogie on a discount. Never even.
No.
Wouldn't even. Good luck.
Rob Baker got a D'Angelico for $500, down from $1,200.
Yeah.
So,
good job.
Brian S., I saw your, I don't know if it's Facebook, Instagram, whatever it is, but I saw you had your new amp day with your Friedman stuff. Very cool. I only saw the pictures of the box, but they look pretty cool. So, yeah, one of the things we were doing, and I invited Philip on so we could tell some stories. We always like to chat and tell some stories. A little bit about the Badlands pickups. And by the way, this isn't like a shameless plug. There's actually a lot of story that went into doing what we did with those. We'd love to tell you that today. And we also have a surprise. We've been sitting on something for a while. Is, as you can imagine, we have a lot of prototypes that get built, and you know, that's how we know how to produce something, is we get prototypes built. And figured we would not only show you some of the pickups in the prototypes, but on the website. Let me actually share my screen real quick. So I'm going to do this. And I'm going to do this, and I would encourage you, don't do it yet, but if you just visit the main landing page, we're going to talk about pickups, some of the backstory behind them, but we also have, we're going to show you these guitars because they exist. They're not for sale, but we have this mailing list because, you know, the reality is we want to hear from you. We want to know your thoughts, and we have this concept of old school and new school, and If you want to be first to get notified if this actually comes to be, you could just put out your name, email, and what are you, you know? Do you want to talk a little bit about old school, new school, Philip, and the reason why we were kind of going down that road?
Yeah. Well, old school is essentially what we already have done, which is go to Floyd Rose style bridge, gloss or satin finished necks that are tinted, the covered pickups that you're kind of used to seeing that have that very 80s look to them with the covers molded over them, and then nickel silver frets. And so the idea was to do something called new school. And so new school would be a unfinished neck. So there'd be no finish on this neck whatsoever. Maybe some gunstock oil or tongue oil, right? Actually, not maybe. That's what's on it. But still no real finish. Stainless steel Jeskar frets. Everything is Jeskar frets. So stainless steel Jeskar frets. Still jumbos. Godot 510 tremolo instead of a Floyd or hardtail. So again, more of a not so much modern tremolo, but a tremolo you're seeing more. And then of course the exposed pickups. So you see the pole pieces. Now the pickups aren't different. They just don't have the covers on them. And just for the record, you can always take the covers off an old school pickup too. But and then of course locking tuning keys. But interestingly enough, this is why Lewis TK was thinking to share with you guys was when we upgraded the hardtail old school, so to speak, hollow flashes and said, oh, from now on, the old school are the hollow flashes with hardtails are going to have locking keys. That's because we had prototypes of new schools with locking keys. And we're like, you know, we like these better. Let's go with this. Originally new school was going to just be locking keys, but now all the guitars that don't have Floyds are going to have locking keys. Or actually, no, I think we're all locking keys on all guitars now.
Yeah, we're doing locking keys on everything. Just makes more sense. You know, it's an upgrade for sure, but for string changes and all that, just makes it a little bit easier for everyone.
Yeah. So that was the idea. The idea was to have two versions of the guitar. Again, a slightly more modern take than the other. That's all. And then the old school, new school was to be, obviously, look, the vibe is to have this 80s vibe, and new school, old school, right, was a thing he said back in the 80s, right? Yeah. And that's all it is.
You know, it's interesting, too. One of the, I would say probably one of the most frequently asked questions we received was about the frets. Everyone seems, and I don't use brainwashed as a negative term, but more of a matter-of-fact term. Everyone seems to be brainwashed that, you know, I want stainless steel frets, right? The whole mystery of they don't wear and they don't, you know, there's no divots and all that stuff. So we were figuring, okay, stainless steel frets is definitely a newer school kind of thing. But we didn't really want it to take away from the nostalgia of what Badlands is, which is your connection to the 80s guitar experience, right? So I figured, you know what? We can set it up the same way for anyone that's bought a Badlands, right? Where you could say, okay, do you want a fixed or do you want a trem? And the price is the same, right? We didn't do any upcharges and any prices. We figured if we do release these, hang on, let me come back over here. Let me share my screen one more time. So if we did release these, you would choose what color and do you want it in the old school or the new school configuration? And the price always remains the same. And as you could tell here, this looks like the hollow flash without the hollow flash finish, because if we go down this road, it will typically resemble the pickup configuration of whatever is in production right now, which just helps keep things as tidy and as quick as we can, because one of the things we pride ourselves on is being able to release something without having to wait for 2 years. And those were built right around the same time as the hollow flash, which is the hum single, which is, you know, I love it. And, you know, if we go down this road, we'll obviously maybe change colors, expand colors, but it will resemble whatever's in production at that given time. And again, you could choose old school, new school. And by the way, I'm curious to know, of course, you could fill out the form, but just a visual, what do you dig? If you want to leave a comment. And again, the big differences are old school has a tinted neck, new school does not. Old school would have branded pickup covers, new school would have open. Old school would have the Godot trim, the Floyd style trim. The new school would have the 510, which is more of like your Strat trim. And I think those are basically the differences. Did I miss anything, Philip? I think that was pretty much
no.
It.
The real main difference in them is really stainless steel with a natural finish neck versus nickels with nickel frets with a finished neck. That's really at the heart of it. I mean, that's really what it is, you know. So, yep. And again, it was really just an idea of like, hey, you know, everybody's saying, you know, not everybody, people say, hey, where's our stainless steel frets? Why don't you do that? For that price, we should get stainless steel frets. I'm like, all right, so here's an option. Let's see if you guys bite. And then like TK was saying, the idea with these would be that, like I said, the next model after the Holo Flash, whatever pickup configuration it's in, that's probably what the next ones will be. Because again, you could tell what we're trying to do. We're trying to make it to where when they're building the guitars on the CNC machines, that we can just say, okay, we'll make 10 extra bodies or 2 extra bodies or whatever, and then make the next, and you know, you know, you get the idea.
Yep. And then we have the pickups, which there's been a lot of talk around the pickups, and I figured this would be a good opportunity to tell you a little bit of the backstory on this. So let me share this with you also, one quick visual. And for Black Friday, Cyber Monday, all of the merch, so what is it, the BFCM Black Friday, Cyber Monday 20. So if you are interested in these, there's 20% off of this. You could use a checkout as well as the merch page, which is on shop merch. So those would apply. And as you could see, they're raw or covered. It's funny, a lot of people were asking about that very question. And I figured, let me show everybody kind of the overview of what you would get or expect. And then we'll tell you a little bit about the backstory on the pickups. So if I share this camera, and there we go. Is that clear, Philip? Can you see that okay?
Yeah, it's absolutely clear.
So branding is obviously very important to us. You know, we want everyone to have a really incredible experience. What are you pointing to?
I'm pointing to the pickups.
Oh, there you go.
I'm trying to Vanna White this thing up, right?
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Yeah.
So Luca, our master, co-owner and master designer, came up with this very nostalgic BGC style, you know, very, very reminiscent to, let me see, very reminiscent to an 80s VHS style box, except, you know, it's fully branded. There's a nice little thank you for your purchase thing. And at the very bottom, which when I get to it, I'll show you. So you would get hardware depending on if it was a single coil, you get the little, the foam cushions or the springs for the humbuckers. And there are three pickups in here, and I'll walk you through each one. So this one here is the neck with a cover on it. And if you didn't want the cover, let me come over here so I can do this while I'm on camera. So they're not affixed, but you know, we can affix it with the cover if that was something, you know, that you were interested in. I would imagine somebody that wanted to put this in, let's say a Les Paul, may not want the cover. But maybe in an 80s rocker style guitar, there would be a cover. And the sticker that would be on there, if you do get something with covers or maybe you don't want the covers affixed, we put the little sticker. This way there's no polarity issues. You just line up the sticker with the logo, and especially in a set, you don't have to guess which direction that the pickups go in. They are fully labeled on the back in terms of the model, the position, so on and so forth. And they are hand wound in the USA. So here's our bridge pickup. Same thing. Make sure that's in camera. Could be with or without the cover. And I don't have the cover for this, but I'll show it to you in one of the guitars. I need a knife to open this. I didn't even open this one yet. I think you have the cover for the single coil, Philip, there.
I do. You might.
Pop this open. But here is our single coil. And also labeled on the back. And the Easter egg with all of this is everything would be online. So we have a QR code, all the wiring diagrams, everything, so we don't have to, you know, print things out. Everything is available online. And that's really kind of the experience that you would get if you would buy the pickups. And obviously it would be marked in terms of what you have. In fact, there's a mid-boost circuit thing there that we had to put there because we are in the process of developing an outstanding circuit, which will show up in a future guitar. And we didn't want to, you know, we try to order in bulk to keep the cost down. So if you see mid-boost circuit there, we were thinking ahead on that one.
And it's probably worth mentioning, this isn't just like a, it's actually very important to mention. This isn't a, hey, it's Black Friday and let's do this. What happened was, or what's happening is, if you're following the Hollow Flashes on social media, you know that they're on track. They're on time. They're not behind. They're not ahead of schedule, right? They're basically on time. Obviously, the shop is building the guitars. And then, like we've said many times, the pickups are made exclusively for us. By someone who winds them for us. They don't do anybody else's pickups, just ours. And
that's his full-time job, by the way.
That's his full-time job, making pickups for us. And so the question became, is he ahead of schedule or is he behind schedule? And he's actually was ahead of schedule, right? And so we're like, well, wait a minute. What happens if that doesn't happen next year or in the future? What happens? If the factory catches up, right? If the guitar manufacturing side does what they continue to promise, which is increase their speed, at some point, I'm not saying we won't be able to, and we won't, but it's going to be difficult to sell aftermarket pickups because we need them for the guitars. You guys may not realize this. We actually, obviously, look, this stuff doesn't just get thought up in a week and in a day. This has been in the works since before the first guitar was ever announced to the people, to you guys. All this stuff, you know, like Lewis said, there's all this, you know, stuff on here on the side that's for the future. But what happened was we had this conversation. We thought, well, what happens if they do catch up and we are able to hit a higher production or these production guitars take off or something like that? So we discussed it and we thought, well, since he's got the time to wind pickups, let's see if anyone's interested in buying some pickups. And then we thought, well, let's announce it on Black Friday. And then Tone King was like, yeah, but you don't want to be like, hey, everybody's got a deal out there and now we want full price. So he decided, why don't we do a 20% off, which I thought was really cool. And so that's why we're doing this. It's just letting you guys know that they exist. But a lot of people have voiced concerns that, you know, they just don't have the basically, you know, almost $3,000 for a guitar. And I understand that. We understand that. I mean, it's a crazy amount of money. No one's ever argued that from the day one. And at the core of it, if you like the sound in the demos you heard of the guitars, you were hearing these pickups. You were hearing the pickups, right? Now you can get the cool pickups and stick them in whatever guitar you want. And like I said, and then, of course, get a cool box. So that's why we thought, and we thought it'd be fun to talk about this, especially since obviously we knew we were going to be talking about Black Friday and the deals and the market as it sits. So,
yeah. And,
hold on before you say anything, didn't want to cut you off. Steve Wright wants to know, does the 20% off discount apply to t-shirts and hats as well? It does. All Badlands merch. It's basically, you got that code, just use it on anything.
And the 20% off for pickups also includes free shipping. So, by the way, if you're international, please reach out because shipping to some places could be more than the pickups themselves. But in the lower 48, shipping is included also. So just FYI on that.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, the pickups are something, and I'll give a demo of the pickups. We, Philip and I, could both give a live demo. We have direct feeds into the live show. But I'll tell you a quick little story about the inception of these pickups. So when Badlands was still a thought, one of the things, in fact, before Badlands, I'm gonna go way back to when you and I first met. I'll leave the names out to protect the innocent, but Philip and I were having a conversation. He had asked somebody about, why do you use certain brand of pickups in your guitar? And we were having this conversation that you can take any pickup, you know, your favorite DiMarzio, your favorite Seymour Duncan, whatever it might be, put it anything, and you kind of feel like you're halfway there, Bon Jovi style, right? We had this whole conversation of, there are some companies that really take pride in the overall tone of the guitar versus just slapping, you know, your favorite set of pickups. Like, I threw DiMarzios in my TTK1. I love the way they sound, and I upgraded it, and life is good. But I could have taken those DiMarzios, put them in any guitar, that type of thing. And I'll give you two examples of companies that do this, and I think it really makes them stand out. So Sur is one of them. In fact, I have a video when I was doing some work with Chuck Levins. I compared their 594 to a Les Paul. Oh, no, was it? I don't remember. No, it was, I did that one too. But this one was a Sur Modern, I forget what it was. And the pickups sounded so good. That guitar sounded unlike any other guitar. And I learned it had a lot to do with the pickups, and they were trying to reach this high fidelity type of sound. And that goes, and PRS is the other one that winds their own pickups, and they wind them specifically for their guitars. And I think that really highlights the overall, when the manufacturer is doing all of that, everything that's kind of in their head gets in the guitar, and I think that's what makes some guitars more special than other guitars. Do you remember that conversation we had, Philip, back when?
Of course.
You want to comment on that at all?
Well, I mean, it's there was a time where, and I hate to say it, but it's true, where companies would do the aftermarket pickups and put them in their guitars, and that was the sign of having a really totally quality guitar and upgraded guitar. You get a guitar like a Charvel, and it would have, a Duncan or a DiMarzio in it. And then I remember the first experience where you walked in the store, like Guitar Center, and all of a sudden you see a Schecter guitar. And actually Schecter, we had this conversation about Schecters, about the first time seeing a Schecter, your brain just went, How did they do this, right? It's so gorgeous. It's, what is this? You know, it's like, it was like Grover Tuning Keys, Seymour Duncans, Tone Pros Bridge, Quilted Maple Top,
loaded.
$399, loaded, you know, $499, and even factored for inflation, you know. It was more expensive than Harley Benton prices now, but a lot less than high-quality guitars like that are now. And you were just, like, blown away by this. And little did you know, over time, that's actually what made those pickups become more pedestrian. They become the pickup that's in every single guitar. And Lewis and I, we had this conversation, like he said, and then, interestingly enough, when we would go and talk to manufacturers, we would be like,
when we'd piss them off.
We'd piss them off. I mean, seriously piss them off with saying things like, why do you use, you know, this aftermarket pickup for your guitar? And they always have the same canned answer of, well, why develop a pickup when somebody already makes a really good pickup? And you're like, yeah, no, we understood that, right? We never gave anybody grief for that, but we kept thinking, but I mean, a pickup is essentially a recipe like anything else. You can, why not mess with the recipe, you know? Especially, and this is the best analogy I can have ever. Do you ever notice that every time an artist that you respect comes out with a signature guitar, it has signature pickups? It's like the artist, the person who makes music, understands the concept of, you know, from top to bottom, this needs to have a look and a voice. Like it, right? You never see them go, yeah, yeah, here's my guitar, and I had him change all these things, and then we threw in Duncan's. Right? Like nothing. And by the way, this isn't a slam against those pickups. As Lewis, as Tonkin kept saying, you know, we love those pickups. We buy those pickups. I use them all the time. He uses them all the time. But it's about the formula, right? Getting that recipe right. And we would always be in shock. And that these certain companies, when you talk to them, there was no interest in creating their own voice with their own look and their own, and then I think actually Tone King said it once, something like, hey, if we ever make it a guitar, we're gonna do it, you know, totally right and get the whole recipe right.
And that was inspired by our early conversations of, if you want to make it yours, then do the whole thing, not just a piece of it, right? So voice was a good word. So when we went to our pickup builder, and Philip and I knew him long before even Badlands was conceived.
Yep.
We knew this very talented guy. I approached him with the idea of Badlands and said, I'm going to talk in Morse code. If anyone's going to spill the beans, I'll let Philip do it, but I'm going to talk in Morse code a little bit. So I went to him and said, there was, you know, I gave him a quick little education. There was this certain window in time where these very good amount, but select pickups were available for about 2 years, maybe 3 years. They were here. People loved them. They were in USA custom shop guitars, as well as some imported models. They were hand wound in the USA. Amazing pickups, some of my favorite, right up there with my DiMarzio Super Distortion / PAF Pro. And then they disappeared, and there's a whole backstory on why. But that window, some of us, perhaps some of us in the room, got to enjoy that when that window was open and these pickups were readily available. In my opinion, some of the best sounding pickups that really capture the essence of what was happening in the 80s, okay? And there were different models of this. I went to our pickup builder and said, this is literally what I want, right? This is what we want. Can you build this? Now, like anything else, when you think about Mesa Boogie, what inspired Mesa Boogie? Well, it was Fender. The Fender circuit actually was the Boogie Mark I, right? Marshall inspired a lot of companies. In fact, Marshall was inspired by the Fender Bassman, if I remember correctly. Like everything, invention starts from inspiration. What inspires you enough to say, I want to do this, right? So for us, it was this very small window, this very small period of time, right around 1986, 1987, maybe 1988, where these pickups were in some of the most amazing USA custom shop guitars, and then they disappeared and used. I've seen them sell for as much as $250. That's if you could find one in good condition. In bad condition, you know, $100, $120 all day long. And how do we resurrect that? How do we put that into our product? Because that was really, again, the voice, using your word, Philip, that was the voice we were after. So it's not just another copy of another pickup. It was really going after the voice of this particular maybe three-year window of the design. Now, like everything else, things evolve. So when you look at our, let me do this real quick. I'm going to put these on here. I'm going to do this. And I'll do that. So it started with the top one, the bridge. You could see the B, okay? And we were after, that's where it began, our M88 bridge. But that's where we started to innovate, right? So our pickup designer said, two bridge pickups, you want something a little bit modified for the neck, right? So the neck is basically a modified, a little bit warmer version of the bridge. So that's, well, these are all 100% our own. It was all based on the tone and the sound, right? It's not like we copied anybody's spec or wines or gauge or anything like that. But the neck was the evolution of the bridge on the M88. What's interesting is for the single coil, again, here's a secret. We wanted to do a stacked single coil. And what we learned is, and I agree with our pickup builder, he said, the problem with stacked single coil is you always lose something. It never sounds like a full humbucker. And he said he's now, a couple of years in, intimately familiar with the M88 series, the bridge and the neck. He said, I can build you something that will match, and the word match I use carefully, match the M88 bridge. So when you're toggling, you don't hear a loss of tone. You don't hear a dropout. He said, so it's an honest-to-goodness single coil, but it will sound better than a double-stacked humbucker in a single coil sound. Leap of faith, they said, send me a prototype. He sent a few, and I was blown away. And I'm not, anyone that knows me knows I like humbuckers, single coils. This is the fattest single coil that I've ever heard, but cleans up nicely and is matched perfectly for, in this particular case, our humbuckers, but perhaps any humbucker out there. Philip, you want to, any comments on that? Because that's
sure,
kind of the backstory on the three pickups that we have for sale right now.
They're saying your mic's low, so while I talk, you might want to check your mic.
Milo. Oh, okay.
Okay, so one of the questions while Tone King was talking was, who is the pickup builder for Badlands? Here's the interesting thing about this. There's no cryptic secret here. It's not a company that's making our pickups. So first of all, keep that in mind, okay? So it's not like when we say they're not making any other pickups besides ours. It's a person makes a guy makes our pickups. Obviously he's got history in the industry and he's made pickups, you know, obviously for other people too. Somebody says he's a YouTuber. No, in fact, you gotta understand he's no one you would, personally know. I don't know.
Nobody
I can't imagine. Nobody even know who he is. And you gotta understand he's whining, you know, basically we tell him how many pickups we need and he goes and winds them and then he ships them to us. And then he makes prototypes when we want prototypes of when we explain to him what we're looking for and what we need. We like his work. We like him as a person. And really what happens, you know, which will make a lot of sense to you guys is he's someone who basically was who knew us both, who we both respected, and the stars aligned, so to speak. He kind of wanted to semi-retire and just make pickups and really not talk to people anymore. You know, he's done with the part of the business. Like, he's not interested in selling, marketing, you know, talking to customers, doing any of that stuff. And as you guys know, I make pickups, and you understand that making pickups is a skill. And so when you find somebody who basically is like, I'll do the labor part, just tell me what to make and when and pay me for it, so to speak. And we were like, this is a great, we can make a perfect relationship with this scenario, right? And so that's why. So essentially, here's what's funny. We could have said, and maybe we made a mistake, we could have said they're Badlands pickups made by us. I mean, it's essentially, that's what it is, you know? If we cut the check slightly differently, he would just be an employee of Badlands and it would be our pickups and that's how it is. There are formulas, there are pickups, we own them, he makes them, and we like his work. The only thing that we have to be pay attention to is like I told you, it's a person, right?
One guy. By the way, is the mic volume a little bit better for everybody? Do I hear, am I a little louder on your side, Philip?
I think so. I hear you fine, so I'm not sure. And I don't know if they're having the same issue with me.
Gotcha.
But,
yeah, it's one guy. One guy,
yeah, it's one guy
who we kind of took out of retirement, and I would almost guarantee that no one in this chat would know who he was even if we told you. Let's put it like that.
Yeah, that's, that's and the only reason, actually, to go further and make it more important to understand, 99.99% of you would know who this person is if we told you, and then sadly enough, 0.1 person, because we have enough viewers collectively, would know him and then probably drive him crazy, right? Which is not what we want. Hey, what are you doing? Are you back in business now? And he's like, no, I'm retired. I'm just, you know, right? Like I said, so that's it. It's a different situation. Like you see, you guys are all, don't trust me, Bruce Eggnator. It's literally no one that you would know. He just works for us. So, like I said, we.
You know, you bring up a good point. For all intents and purposes, he's a Badlands employee. Just,
yeah.
It's an accounting thing, right?
Yeah. So it's just kind of funny. So the
can you tell the backstory without saying too much on why these pickups are so special? Is that
can you tell everybody that off? Yeah, I don't have any issues telling the story. So the pickups, okay, so obviously the Badlands guitars are inspired by all this amazing 80s iconic instruments, okay? And it's a hodgepodge, and I don't, to lack of a better term, of things like that we liked from the Kramers, from the Jacksons, from Aria Pro, you name it, right? Like guitars that just were cool and brought in. And so the pickups are no different. Although they are original designs, again, they're based off some kind of 80s iconic history. And so if you guys recall, for a short time, Jackson Guitars made their own pickups. And what's interesting about that, which is an interesting time for Jackson, is they're known for two things. If you think of Jackson pickups, you actually know them for two things: making some of the worst pickups and some of the best pickups, right? It's a weird, that's why he said when TK's like, there's a window,
right? Very small window.
A very small window. What was the guy's name that was making them? I forgot.
Paul Gagan.
So for a short time in Jackson Guitar's history, a man by the name Paul Gagan, who you probably won't know, but
and
just
it's
understand,
not him, by the way. Just
it's
for
not.
The
yeah, yeah. By the way, yeah. Who's making our pickups isn't Paul Gagan either. Paul Gagan, after designing and building pickups for Grover Jackson during the best years of the Jackson pickups, he's since left. He worked at Gibson. He's designed pickups for G&L. He's known in the industry. So he made these iconic pickups. And what's interesting about them is why Jackson did that. DiMarzio pickups and Jackson had a falling out at some point, and DiMarzio would not sell Jackson pickups. Right. I think obviously then he could get pickups from Mighty Might at the time. Some people now associate Mighty Might with being inexpensive parts, but during the 80s, they were inexpensive-ish, but they were still, you know, good quality components. I still think they make good quality components now. And basically he got lopped off from that too, so to speak. And that's when Paul Gagan came in and they started doing their original pickups. What's interesting about this, and why we keep certain things cryptic, and this is a treat for you guys to on the Tone Kings channel, whether you realize it or not, we're not trying to hide things from anybody. That's not our personalities and our style, but there are certain things that we've paid attention to, that we've kept our fingers on the pulse, so to speak, and we would like to get our footing in for having the knowledge and the intuition to do these things. I just want to say this because this is probably, you know, just it's important to say, you know, TK's like, Phil, Jackson made these great pickups. Why are they so great? And so we would talk about them, and all of us, you know, all four owners, we would talk and we'd be like, okay, this is why they were great. This is what the, you know, this is what happened during that time. But the bigger question is, why the hell doesn't Jackson reproduce them, right? I mean, why does Jackson?
We have.
Yeah,
exactly.
Why is Jackson? I mean, Jackson Custom Shop Guitars is sticking in again. I love Seymour Duncan pickups. TK loves Seymour Duncan pickups. I loved, obviously, DiMarzio pickups. Larry's a good friend. Why would you put production pickups that you can get anywhere into these $6,000-$7,000 custom shop instruments when you yourselves have a few moments in the pickup history line of cool and great pickups that are highly collectible, by the way. Some of these Jackson pickups are go for good money on the market when they do come up. And of course, one of our concerns was, especially more so in my concern was, you know, Tone King, when we got the prototypes and Tone King's like, okay, this is the pickup that I remember, but you know, slight improvements were done. And I was like, okay, he's happy. We went through the pickups. And of course, my first concern was, well, once we do this, Jackson's going to do this because of course Fender's got winding capabilities too. And it made no sense why they weren't doing this anyway. By the way, they can make those pickups way cheaper and they own the brand Jackson stick on them. So, I mean, they can muscle us out real fast. But we wanted to get our teeth in first, right? I guess if that makes any sense, we wanted, and I think we did it. I mean, the first run of the red lines, you know, people who have these guitars, man, these things sound fantastic. You know, the people are kind of, we can sense it. It doesn't take a genius for two gear reviewing YouTube channels to see how many we sold. That could be, and TK, you can jump in too anytime. How fast these guitars sold, maybe that's the hype of the YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
But watching how people have kept them, how they love them, they keep playing them, right? That is the testimonial of the overall, of the sound, the components, the fit and finish, the feel, you know.
By the way, is the audio okay? It's funny. I feel like I'm screaming in my headphones, but can everyone hear me okay?
I hear you perfect.
Okay. So here's an interesting little tidbit. You know, when we were, and then I'll get back to the pickups. One of the things, just to be clear, we didn't start a guitar company and say, hey, let's just be the next bunch of fools to start a guitar company because we think it's a good idea. And I laugh because that happens a lot, right? Let's just start a guitar company. It actually started Luca, who I think is in the chat. I think I saw him. We were talking about reissue guitars. And the question I had was, why can't companies get reissues straight? Why are they always different? If it's a reissue, shouldn't it, like, you know... And that's when we, again, Philip said it best, keeping your hand on the pulse. And it was the same thing with the pickups. Why isn't Jackson making these amazing pickups anymore? They have the capability to do this. Why aren't they doing it? And then they come out with a reissue on something and they wouldn't even put the thing that was most exciting in there.
Right.
And that was really kind of the birth of Badlands, was let's try to, of course, it's going to be our spin. We're going to make decisions on, hey, let's use a Goto instead of a Trem. In fact, I just took apart an 80-something BC Rich guitar. Guess what's in the back? I'll actually get it if you want to see it. It's a Goto Trem, right? It's actually true to era. Anyway, so we had, you know, guitars. Not everyone keeps the guitars that they have, but one of our missions was to set up a system where your investment is protected. How do you do that? Well, you don't make a lot of them, okay? And by the way, we practice what we preach. If there's something limited edition, Philip and I and our co-owners are more interested in that than when it's not a limited edition. So everything we're making will be limited and like a hard retirement afterwards. Well, we had someone that just sold their red line. In fact, we posted it up on Instagram and, you know, trying to give everyone a boost if we could help, you know, someone that wants to get out of it. You know, people's financial situations change. It's the holidays. They have kids. They have to buy gifts.
Right.
He got more money for that guitar than he paid for it. And I was thrilled about that because that tells me that we did it right. His investment was protected and he sold it for more than he paid. And that made me really happy because what would make me unhappy is if he took a bath and sold it at a loss.
Right.
Right. It just tells
me. Which is a big conversation we had many nights before launching the brand.
Mm-hmm.
Was, you know, how do you insulate people the best you can? And again, it's not about like buying them and flipping them, but like TK said, you know, if you love it, we know how guitars work. We got guitars. When you love them, you keep them. And when you love them, and then sometimes, you know, it's not even that you don't love guitars anymore. Sometimes you just find something you love more and it's time to move on. So.
Yep. And, you know, getting back to the pickups, it's funny how it started with a single pickup. We chose one that we have a few favorites. We chose one. It was the M88. It was the M88. We started there, and that worked into the N, which is a little softer than the bridge. And then the M81, which is 100% our own. The M81 was because we couldn't get, and trust me, I had a lot of prototypes. We wanted a single-spaced humbucker, and it just didn't sound like a humbucker. And our guy said, trust me, I can give you a perfectly balanced single coil pickup. And he nailed it, we're going to do a live demo of these. And the one pickup that's not here, Philip, when you came to my place and I put a particular guitar in my hand and said, this is the M89, you were like, oh, this is nice, you know. So we have some stuff also, but what we don't want to do is release a pickup that hasn't made its way into a guitar yet. But a lot of stuff that we're working on. I'll go back to what I've always said: capacity is the biggest challenge. In fact, we're only winding 20 pickups a week. So when you think about quality control and you think about trying to do it right the best way we can, we're kind of anything but a factory, right?
Yeah.
So our production numbers are low. Our timelines are a little longer than we want it to be, but still competitive. It's not 2 years like if you were to order for a custom shop from one of the big boys. But we're tracking for about 6 months, 20 pickups a week. You know, it's about as small as it gets to produce these things. So should we do some live demos?
Oh, sure.
And I want to show the prototypes. So. Unveiling for the first time. In fact, I'm going to change cameras here. I'm going to move this over. And I'm going to go on this camera. I'm waiting for everything to catch up a little bit. Okay. So what we have here is our, you know, it's funny. We called it, we had a custom graphic, and this was our custom color, right? It was just an internal way of being able to differentiate it. This is a pearl white. I don't know if you could capture that, but it's almost a metallic pearl white, very subtle, not overdone. This has a tinted maple neck. We went with, for the custom color, we wanted to standardize because we figured people that bought a custom color may want it a little quicker. So we're doing the gold logos on all, like, let's just call this a custom color or a custom color production series. And this one has the Godot Floyd style. And this has the M88 and the M81. And we'll start right there. And then I'll do a compare and contrast between this and the new school. This is the old school that you're looking at right here with the tinted neck. And you'll see it'll look more tinted. So here's clean, and I will start it here. Let's do this. I'll back up a little bit. I'll bring the mic over so you could all hear me. Okay, so this is the single coil. This is the M88 bridge. I'm gonna kill the. I'm gonna go on some dirty. Let's check this out. So a quick little, let me come back over here. A quick little, Philip, did that come across okay, the audio?
Oh, yeah. I liked it.
Okay. So hopefully you got to hear how nicely balanced, and when I was doing a little bit of lead on the single coil, how I like to use the word swollen because it just sounds swollen to my ears, but how it sounded, the single coil on the lead stuff to me. Again, just real big, thick, meaty in a single coil, which I don't know. I think sounds good. Any questions, Philip? Anything you want to add on about this one here?
You know, a funny, interesting thing might be interesting to know about that white guitar. I asked Shauna to do a project for me. This is about a couple months ago when we were talking about colors for guitars. And I said, we're looking at colors for guitars. And, you know, she's a woman. So I asked her about, you know, hey, what do you think of these colors? What do you think of those colors? We're talking colors. And she came with great ideas. She watched just hours and hours. She had a playing in the background of hours and hours and hours and hours of rock and roll and metal videos from the 80s. And she actually like made up a little report for me kind of thing and told me, that the number one, and showed me actually, by the way, and this little trivia, maybe Tone King doesn't even know this, the number one guitar color in all the videos is white. And she showed me reference after reference, and even video after video, I was like, oh, not this video, this one they're using, I was white. I was like, why do I not remember all of these guys, these rock stars, playing white guitars? But it is by far, like three out of every five guitars in the videos are white guitars. So
I would guess that the same reason why I like white guitars for video, they just pop out. Black guitars are tough to see.
Yeah.
When you have a lot of background stuff, especially when you're dressed in black, you know.
John Clark says, curious, why no tone control? It's not rock and roll, man. You don't need tone in rock and roll. No. There's a ton of reasons, but main thing is that's actually a real common thing in 80s guitars to not have a tone control. You know, guitar players started removing tone control. You got to understand, you know, when you're trying to capture the 80s, you're in a problem. Here's the problem you're in. There, a lot of guitar players did things because they were trying to get every dripping little thing, amount of distortion they could out of the amps. They were trying to get the amps, you know, and so sometimes removing a tone control, believe it or not, that little bit just sent a little teeny bit more signal to the amp. Taking the chrome covers off pickups, that literally started, I don't know if you know this, because remember pickups, humbuckers came with chrome covers, the, you know, nickel covers. They didn't come plastic bobbins exposed. One of the best fun pickup facts out there about Zebra pickups is that's where Zebra pickups came from. They didn't think anybody would ever see the bobbins. So when they didn't have all the material for black, they just started making cream ones. And when they just mismatched them, they didn't care. And the reason is because the chrome covers nickel covers. The nickel covers were what they thought they would do. They didn't realize that one day some rock guy would say, hey, man, if you take off the chrome cover, you get a little bit more distortion, a little bit more signal to the amp. And it is technically true if you put it on a scope, but it's so silly low. And so that's, you know, part of the iconic 80s thing. And you have to understand you know, like I've said before, when I jumped in on the Badlands thing, when these guys were talking about it, the one thing that I understood is that they're right. A lot of manufacturers, for some reason, they go to great details to recreate a guitar from the 50s or the 60s. Man, like we even found the exact plastic, you know, mold. I mean, even Fender's redone. I don't know if you know this. Fender's redone the mold of the plastic knobs on vintage guitars 3, 4, 5 times, each time claiming this mold, this slight variation in how the knobs look is more accurate. And yet when they make 80s guitars, like TK says, they just kind of, oh yeah, that's kind of how it was.
Yep.
Yeah. So.
All right. Let me show this now.
Okay.
So. This here. I'm going to hold this. Hopefully they don't fall. I'm going to change cameras. And hopefully you could see. Actually, let me cross them. Crisscross them. And try to capture the light. Is that coming across okay in terms of which is tinted and which isn't?
A little bit, yeah. I mean, you can tell the one in the front's a little more tinted than the back one.
But if we do that, let's see, the light, it's all the lighting. There you go. I think that might be a little better. But this one here is more of a natural neck. Let me put this one down. Well, it's actually not more of, it is. This is the, now the only thing here is this has pickup covers on it, but if and when we sell the modern, it will have open bobbins, okay?
Yeah, they'll look like.
Oh, do you have open bobbins on yours?
Yeah.
Oh, there you go. There it is.
Yeah, like that.
It's actually the same exact guitar, except he doesn't have the bobbins on his, and I have it on mine. So the 510 trem, a little more subdued. Still hum single in this particular case. The natural neck, satin, but natural. Of course, three-piece. Locking tuners. The gold logo. And the same pickups. And stainless steel frets. So let's see if the stainless steel frets have any bearing on the tone. here we go. We'll start with clean. So that's, I'm going to come to this camera. It's a little bit more visible, I think. I'm trying to get you so you could see the toggle. So we'll start up here. Okay, here we go. And if I go over to the bridge, actually sounds. Philip, I don't know if you caught it, but it actually sounds a little brighter, maybe a tad brighter. I don't know if that comes across.
It, I mean, obviously the materials change tones, right? Mm-hmm. The tricky part about stainless steel frets is when people go, "Oh, they're brighter sounding," because that's usually the observation. They are. Keep in mind though that the difference between nickel silver frets and stainless steel is not this. It's because there's degrees of nickel silver stainless steel or nickel silver frets to the point where there's a nickel silver frets that are just right under the hardness of stainless steel frets. And by the time you get them that hard, the tone does get a little brighter sounding. So, I mean, it's kind of, you know, acoustically is what you'd want to do. Like if I... But what's funny is, here's what's really funny. So here's a question that'll break your brain as a guitar player. So the question I have for everybody is, if I take stainless steel strings and put them on a nickel fret guitar, and I take pure nickel strings and put them on a stainless steel fret guitar, then do the guitars now sound exactly the same?
It's a good question.
The answer is no, because the way the magnets and the pickups pick up the nickel versus the stainless steel. But that's the whole point. The reason I like that stain is to think, hey, look, I like pure nickel strings. They deaden the sound a little bit. I would imagine that if you put pure nickel strings on stainless steel frets, obviously you're going to dampen those highs. So I guess the whole argument is that you can really adjust your tone controls. I'm not 100% for or against any kind of fret. I really like the idea that stainless steel frets most likely don't have to be refretted or changed. That's really my favorite part about them. You know, to wear through stainless steel frets, you have to really be, you got to be gigging, man. You got to be gigging a lot. I've seen people do it a little bit, but it takes a lot. So.
Yeah. I don't know. For me personally, I like nickel frets. I don't know. Why do you think they don't put stainless steel frets on Les Pauls today?
Well, they're not going to put any stainless steel frets on anything traditional. It's more expensive to put stainless steel frets on guitars. The expense to put on them is not double the price, but it's enough to where if you can justify not doing it. Let me put it this way. Here's a better term. If guitar manufacturers had to warranty wearing out frets, I would be shocked that they would stick with nickel silver, right? They would put stainless steel and be done with it. So the idea that they know they can put nickel silver frets on there and sell the guitar, and then once it's yours, by the time there's, you know, a year out, they're not responsible for the frets. That's why they do it, because it's cheaper, essentially.
Think about this. They don't even, once upon a time they did, but they don't even warranty wood shrinkage anymore.
Yeah, I know.
Well, so now if the wood shrinks, which by the way is a manufacturing defect.
Right.
That's on you, not them.
Yeah, I know.
All right. Let's hear.
Wait, there was a question. Hold on. There was a couple questions. Okay. There was one question I thought I saw. There was a couple, but there was one in particular I thought was really good. Steve Wright wanted to know, can you remove the covers on the current Badlands models? You can. The covers are not like chrome or nickel covers where they're soldered on. These are plastic. And these covers, more importantly, are not to be confused with the covers you see on EMG pickups. The covers on EMG pickups are not plastic. They look plastic. They're actually metal on the top. That's why if you look at them, you'll actually see on the top of an EMG pickup, you'll see the outline is different than the sides, because there's a different type of material on there. The reason that's important is how these are installed is they'll either hot glue them on or they'll use double stick tape. The original ones we were getting were hot glue. I think they're double stick taping on them now, which means you just reach over and just, like we just did, you just pull them off. And that's, so if you want to remove covers, you can. And if you want to put them back, you can. I've actually talked to two people, ironically, who told me they didn't like the covers. They took them off, and then they said the guitar didn't look as nice, you know, with the covers off, and they put them back on. So I thought, okay, you know, I've kind of have the same experience. You know, I think it's, you know, it's one of those things. It's what your preference is, man. But we left it to where you could choose.
Yep. So, Philip, do you want to, I was really enjoying your tone before. Do you want to give a lead lick on your...
Sure. You want me to use this one?
The new school?
The new school?
Yeah. Let's do that.
So, okay, I'm going to turn off my mic. So my mic's going. The important part. I'm going to switch down to the neck.
It sounded good.
And that's which kind of what you want. You want the neck to not dive EQ wise. This is the important part. The neck pickup, what you don't want is it to thin out really, really bad. Because then you're fighting, you know, you're fighting your own amp's tone, especially on stage. You know, all of a sudden you're just thin. But what you do want is it to clean up, because that's one of the magic things that neck pickups do. And what's great about that is that when you take the volume control, like on the bridge, you turn it quarter turn back. Oops, and if I don't hit the whammy bar, hold on. That's the bridge. Now I'm gonna go to the neck. I'll take my mic. And then of course back to the neck.
Sounds really good.
Yeah, it's really important to balance them. And a little important thing to know about 80s rocker dudes back in the 80s. A lot of them loved the humbucker single, you know. I mean, it's notorious, you know, George Lynch had it. I mean, yep. Tons of guitar players had it. Jake Ely had it, although he had humbucker single, still the same concept. He was going from humbucker to the single coil neck. A lot of players, it's really an interesting thing. They went to dual humbuckers and then they kind of went back to the humbucker singles. It's because they learned that it was a lot easier to get the amps to react to a single coil differently than a humbucker. But here's what's important to know about them. Almost all those guys were using a boost pedal all the time, and they were using that to help the single coil not thin out so bad. And like Tone King mentioned earlier, that's why it was important to get these two pickups, that when you're switching between them, to not do that. Now, here's what's important. If you took an LTD guitar, okay? If you take a $300 to $500 LTD guitar, I'm pretty confident of this, and it has a humbucker single and styled like this Badlands, you could get it to do what this is doing with a boost pedal on. You just have to leave it on. Find the sweet spot on the boost pedal, usually like where the unity gain is, and then turn it on and leave it on, and you would get the same effect. But the beautiful part about this is this is achieved without having to do all that. So there you go.
Someone asked for a little chug. Let me do a little. I'll do it on the new school. I still have the thing plugged in. I don't know. How did that come across?
Sounded great. No, it sounded great. Somebody asked what the red one. So I had the red one, and it's currently not here because we're doing more stuff to it. I mean, that's just how it works. We're constantly doing stuff to these because we have to keep working on the next idea and the next, you know, what are we going to do next? How are we going to approach it? So for the record, the red one is exactly like TK's white one, just red. So picture red.
So let's do this because, and Grumpy Mike, dude, as always, thank you so much for the super chat. Let's do this before we wrap up because someone was, I think it was the great Vanzini that was asking. So the discounts are 20% off of the pickups, okay? You could choose with the cover or without the cover. It's free shipping in the lower 48 states. If you're international, please just send us a note. Again, hand wound one at a time by one guy, and they are our pickups, right? So those are for sale. We have the M88 bridge, the M88 neck, and the M81 single coil, okay? And this is what we showed tonight, our old school, new school. There is no order form since they're not for sale. But one of the things we wanted to do, you know, it's funny, we got beat up a little bit of, I didn't know, nobody told me, right? And it's just the reality of when you're only selling 50 guitars and we announce it, some people don't check email over the weekend. Some people take a couple of days to catch up and then it was too late. So we figured, you know what, let's try something a little different, level the playing field. And we put together a mailing list. And you even get to choose old school and new school. Obviously, we're not locking anybody in. We just kind of want to pull the audience of what you know, what's more popular, right? And if and when we release these, this email list that we're collecting right here will be hit first. So if you have any interest in this at all and want first crack at it, if you sign up here, you'll be notified first. And the way it would work is, so imagine an order page where you would say, hey, this is the guitar, right? You know, the shape, this is the GX1 body shape. The pickup would be hum single, and the old school would be nickel, silver frets, tinted neck, Floyd style Godot trim. Or new school would be a Godot trim, not the big floating trim. Natural neck with stainless steel frets. Those are really the difference. So you could pick your color and your old school or new school configuration. And that's it. The prices would be the same whether you pick old school or new school. And if you want old school in red or new school in red, we don't care. You want old school or new school in gunmetal, we don't care. You want old school or new school in pearl, we don't care. But that's kind of where we're at. By the way, did you see the colors, Philip? Do you like those?
I do. Cheech says, why is Who Winds Your Pickups a secret? Okay, Cheech, here it is. His name's Martin. It's not, I hope you understand. We're having a little fun with this because when people ask us, like, who's winding the pickups? I'm like, you wouldn't. His name's Martin.
Doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter because it's not a company. It's our employee. He's a guy, you know, he makes them for us. He works for us. And he's just a person. So we could literally just tell you anybody's name. His name's Dave Smith, but his actually name's Martin. His name's Martin. We're not OEMing them through, if that's what everybody's probably concern is, that we're not OEMing them through another pickup manufacturer or something like that. That's not what's happening. We just need you to understand that we have one person winding the pickups. That's it. That's the only thing that's really important for you guys to understand. We don't have 2, 3, 4 people. We have a person who winds just our pickups all day, obviously, because he doesn't make any pickups besides ours. But we want you to know capacity. That's all. That's the issue. Let's see, what else? There's something else. Rosewood. Oh, Ryan Hall said Rosewood ? No, these are all maple. There's been a lot of discussion over this period of time with us about, you know, do we have more of a, you know, talk to the community approach about future models? Do we have the, you guys like even vote in or vote out what we might do, or do we just come up with it on our own? How do we do this? And that's what this is. This is a test the waters. Hey, we're letting you see some of these prototype ideas, and you guys can go to the website and tell us what you think. We're not asking you to buy anything. There's nothing to buy anyways. It's more of a, hey, get on the list, tell us which one you liked better. And then if or when we ever do this, you'll be the first ones notified we're doing it. A couple people asked about pricing. we don't have any pricing because part of the pricing on these, it's a different strategy on a, we're calling this like custom color, right? Those other ones are custom graphics. Custom graphics definitely, as you understand, have a bigger choking point. One person has to do the graphics, right? It's a very, you know, and to be honest with you, probably one person is going to do all the custom colors, but it's a lot faster to paint a guitar than it is to paint detailed stuff. So again, this is more of a fact-finding mission. Also, we thought it'd be fun. TK was like, hey, let's share this with everybody on Black Friday. That's why I'm at way past my bedtime.
Yep. And, you know, there's also a hidden agenda here, okay? One of the things I mentioned earlier was part of the business model is to preserve the value. So anyone that buys a guitar, that value of that instrument will be preserved. Here's what we don't want to do. We don't want to build 50 red, 50 gunmetal, 50 pearl, and then we realize, you know what? Nobody liked the red, and now we have to blow them out. We don't ever want to do that, right? We don't want anyone to buy a guitar to then later realize, oh, they're blowing them out. Why are they blowing them out? We don't ever want that to happen. So part of sharing this with you, especially with these, because this, we're kind of tippy-toeing into a production series. And production series, again, one of the things, like Philip had mentioned earlier, we've kept our pulse on the things we love and the things we don't love. And one of the things we don't love is a lot of times manufacturers will guess what they should build, and next thing you know, it's on Musician's Friend Deal of the Day every week, right? We don't ever want to do that because
we're seeing it this Black Friday. Right?
It hurts you. It hurts the consumer, and we don't want to do that. So, if you love this thing, and I'll just be illustrative. Let's say 20 people say, "Hey, we love this idea. We want in on this idea." We may make 20 guitars, right? Not 100. So that type of thing. Part of this exercise is for you to preserve the value of every instrument that we sell to you. So if come the day you ever sell it, you could say, I am one of 10 people that own this old school Arrest Me Red model, right? That's part of the goal. And we're doing that is really built into the business model. We don't ever want to miss the mark on what we're building. So hopefully that gives you a little insight into in terms of why we're asking.
Yeah, and it's fun. It's really this. We just wanted to share this with you guys. This is what we do when you're not around. It just basically looks just like this. Just you guys aren't in the chat. And then we're like, okay, well, what if we do this? What if we add that? So we thought I'd share.
And there's lots of, I could talk to Philip on the line for 4 hours talking about these three guitars.
Yeah.
Old school, new school. What else should we do? It's the conversation seemed to never end, but I would sum it up with Philip's final sentiment of this is a lot of fun, guys and gals. So thank you. Anyway, I think that concludes the live show. Went into a little bit of overtime, but always happy to answer any questions everyone has. And Philip, it's always a pleasure having you on. This is good stuff. So thank you for being here tonight, Philip.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me. And also thank you for thinking of this, because like I said, this was his idea. He's like, let's do it. Let's go have some fun Friday night. I'm like, all right, let's do it.
Yep. So I hope everyone has a great weekend. There's a whole bunch of you in here. So I'm just going to give a group bad boy to everyone that joined tonight. Thank you so much. And if you dig the show, give us a thumbs up on the way out. Check out the website. It's the first link in the description of the video. And Philip, if you want to say goodbye, and then we'll wrap up.
Goodbye. Now we're going to wrap up.
No your gear.
Oh man, no.
Don't know your gear.
Do you ever get burnt out on the, give you one of those bad boys right there to get burnt out on it?
Sometimes. But what the funny thing is, when I don't do it, people remind me.
Yeah, I've tried to fade out and know your gear. I have tried 3 times, whether people realize it or not. I've tried to either not do it or downplay it or figure out how to get around it. Not for any negative reasons. I don't have any issues. Just kind of, I'm like concerned people are sick of it. And like you said, then I even get emails. You ever get emails? They're like, why'd you not do it? I'm like, oh crap, what? That's a thing? All right. Yep. So.
All right. Well, goodbye, everybody. Sayonara. Have fun. Enjoy your weekend. And hopefully get a good deal on that piece of gear that you were after. And we'll see you all next week. Thank you and goodbye.
Thank you and goodbye.